I mean, it's not the most beautiful thing in the world, but it is a lot better looking and does actually go with the house versus the hole you were planning on digging in the ground. So as many of you know, I've officially moved into my brand new house. But unfortunately for me, that basically means that I have to rebuild not only my entire studio, my pit fire, reorganize everything, throw a lot of stuff away, keep a lot of stuff I'm not supposed to. That basically means that today I'm going to have to rebuild the entirety of my pit fire kiln that you've probably seen in previous episodes. I usually leave it partially open so that the air can get in there and the fire can feed off of the oxygen and keep on going. I've actually never been inside of a hammock before and now I am stuck. Since I have to basically rebuild my entire pit fire kiln today, I kind of figured number one, I would take you along that journey with me, and number two, I would show you guys not only how I built my pit fire, but why I built my pit fire the way I built my pit fire. I mean, in all reality, I have to rebuild this thing anyway. I figured I might as well record it and show you guys how to do it. But there are a couple of things I need to explain to you first. Okay. Now, I completely and totally understand that there are some people who are watching right now who just want to see me build the pit fire kiln. They don't want any of this extra fluff. They just want to see me build it. They're visual learners. They're not used to me explaining things the way I explain things. For those people, you can just click this timestamp in the scroll bar down below right now. It'll just show me building the pit fire kiln if that's all you want to see. There's your candy. You can go scroll Instagram now looking at booty pics. But before I actually start building this pit fire, there's about three or four quick things I have to explain to you. This is my pit fire kiln. I've been firing stuff in here for quite some time now, and I'm proud to say I built it myself. It's an extremely easy design. Now before we get started, there's probably about three or four things I have to explain to you. Number one, there's probably some traditional potters right now who are shaking their fists at the camera going, "That's not a pit fire. Back in my day." And that person would be absolutely correct. This is not what you would call a traditional pit fire. A traditional pit fire is basically where you dig a big hole in the ground, hopefully you own that property, and then you wait for the dirt to dry out. You might want to insulate it, a lot of people don't, and then you set it on fire and cover it to insulate or keep in all of the heat. We're not doing that. We're doing something much easier and much more time and resource efficient. But here are some of the reasons why you might not want to dig a giant hole and just set it on fire. Reason number one, you are going to have to own your own property if you're going to dig a giant hole and set it on fire in any part of your house, including your back or front yard. If you are not one of the lucky or privileged few that either own land or own your own house or property, it's gonna be really difficult to explain to your landlord why there's a giant patch of scorched earth that can never grow anything again in part of their house. Or you'll have to do the extra work to refill that hole back in with fresh dirt, in which case, you'll be lucky if anything grows in that one spot ever again. Number two, this is an extremely self-contained method. If you guys have ever seen any of my pit fire videos, it's an above ground pit fire. It's not in the ground, which means that if it rains, the ground doesn't get soggy. If it's too hot and I want to put a fire in the ground, I don't have a fire danger as much as I would with this self-contained above ground pit fire. It's honestly just less of a liability for you to build it this way instead of digging a giant hole in your yard. You also don't have to really go to the city planner and ask those people if you can dig underneath your house or dig a hole inside of your ground or if you're gonna run into any cable wires, power lines, or pipes. All of that is taken out because you're not even digging into the ground. Number three, I can move this thing anytime, anywhere I want to, in almost any place, as long as I don't live in a really small apartment. I moved from my old house to this house right here. I picked up the same exact bricks that I used for the last pit fire, and I just moved them to the new house. It took me like 3 hours. I didn't have to buy brand new bricks. I didn't have to dig a brand new hole. I didn't have to do any extra work aside from just moving the kiln. It's extremely easy to not only take care of, it's also easy to move. Number four, from my experience and many people who have used my pit fire kiln before's experience, this thing holds a little bit more heat than a traditional pit fire. And I keep having to remind you, a traditional pit fire is just a hole in the ground. The bricks I'm sitting on here are pretty good at keeping in heat, and they leave little tiny cracks so that air can get in so the fire can still feed and keep on heating up, as long as you put enough fuel inside of that actual little pit fire kiln. And the final thing I'm gonna tell you guys is, to be honest with you, it just looks nicer. Like, look at this. Do you want this in your backyard? When guests come over and they go, wow, like you built that? You built that by hand? And you can put your hand on your hips all Wonder Woman style and be like, yeah, it took me like 3 hours and I just went to Home Depot, it was cool. The guy with the nerd shirts and the bad facial hair on YouTube showed me how to do it. For those of you who are worried about the actual aesthetics of your house, this is nicer, easier to clean because it's really, really contained, and you can use it for things other than pit fires. If you wanted to have like some kind of party in your backyard, for all intents and purposes, this is an actual pit fire as well as a pottery pit fire. It has a dual purpose, but I don't think anybody's gonna be impressed with your hole in the ground. I'm actually really fortunate to already have the bricks, so I don't have to go to Home Depot specifically for these bricks, because this is most likely the hardest part of the job, just getting these bricks to your house. For anyone who's wondering off the bat, there are exactly 60 bricks here, and this is the exact number I needed to build the pit fire at the height that I wanted to build it. You don't have to build it this high. You can easily do 40 or 50 if you want a shorter one. I like to make stuff half the size of a human being sometimes. So you don't need this many, but the last time I built this, a lot of people were asking how many bricks I got to build it to that height. So before we even get to that portion, this is 60 bricks. And now it's 61 bricks. Potter tip. For anyone who's not at this step yet, I highly suggest on your way to Home Depot, if you don't have one or you already do have one, either buy yourself or get out your dolly. You can transport about 10 of these per dolly trip if you are good with balancing stuff. But doing these by hand is fairly difficult. We're not going to Home Depot for these bricks because I already have these bricks, of course. We're going to Home Depot for some other stuff, but I will be walking by the brick section of Home Depot to show you the actual cost of how much 60 bricks would cost, or at least how much they would cost per brick. It's really important that you don't get straight bricks, that you get these kind of fluted ones, because they fit nicely together in a nice big circle. Okay, so we are at Home Depot now. I'm gonna find those bricks for you guys because I want you to know how much they cost, at least for my area. They're really not that expensive, to be honest with you. So these are the kind of bricks that I bought last time. I will say these are the smaller version of them, and although they are technically underneath a dollar, if you buy them in bulk, number one, they're cheaper, and secondly, there are bigger versions of it, just in case you want a bigger pit fire kiln. But for now, we do need to go and get some volcano rocks. Okay, so they're not actually called volcano rocks, they're called black lava. I just prefer calling them volcano rocks, but these are about $5 a bag. They're not that expensive, and even though they are decorative, we do still need them to cover the bottom of our kiln. We don't want to burn directly on our grass or on anything that we have in our yard. So this is going to act as a nice layer in between this fire and whatever we have in our yard. One of the things that's really important that we are definitely going to need for this is some type of cover to our pit fire, right? So what I did last time was I bought an actual pit fire from Home Depot, took the cover off, and just kind of threw away the bottom part, and that was the lid to my pit fire. Okay, so I just checked and sadly they don't have it, but I will find it for you on Amazon or eBay or wherever, and I will post it for you right here. It should be about 20 or 30 bucks. All I did is I bought it and then I took the little top off of it and I use that as a cover now. Now we're gonna take our giant Home Depot shopping cart now and put it all the way back where it goes, either in the store or in that little space where they pick up carts, because we're not pieces of trash. Making the original pit fire the way I made it last time at my old house isn't really that hard. All you have to do is get these bricks, which if you got the right ones, you should have the ones with the cut edges, the little fluted edges, just like this. You put them down and you try and get them as close as you can together while still making one complete circle. Here. Find it, Cool, we have the base to our pitfire, and now all we have to do is keep adding layers and keep offsetting them. The cool thing about this is that you can add as many layers as you want. So let's imagine you wanted to build something very small. You can very easily put about 3 layers of this, and that's as high as you're gonna go. But if you just wanted to get more bricks and keep adding more bricks, you can very easily make something way up here. I've actually fired something about this big before by just adding bricks. And then I put the bricks over in the corner just in case I want to use them again for something that tall. If I don't need anything that tall, I'll simply take them away. Potter tip. You guys are probably going to see very movable spaces at the bottom of this. See this? I can move this brick very easily. I don't want that. So before you go up one more level or one more layer, you're gonna wanna make sure that there's no space in between every single rock. Because these are kind of fluted in like this, you can very easily just push them in a little bit. And sooner or later, as long as they're at least a little bit even, they will get rid of those spaces. Every single layer that we go up, we will have to offset them just to make sure that there's not a lot of cracks. So let's imagine you have all these spaces right here. Well, you don't have to imagine it, we actually do. Instead of placing them directly on top of each other like this, go ahead and find one of these cracks and put it directly in the middle of that crack. And just follow the pattern that you followed on your very first layer. Okay, we're pretty much done, and that doesn't look too bad. I mean, it's not the most beautiful thing in the world, but it is a lot better looking and does actually go with the house versus the hole you were planning on digging in the ground. I actually have a few more bricks, but I'm not going to add them because I usually don't make stuff that high and pit fire it. So I think that's a good amount. This way I can shove a bunch of small stuff in there and get more yield out of my pit fires. Do you guys remember that volcano rock I got earlier? The main reason I got this volcano rock is because if you can look all the way down at the bottom of the pit fire, you will see that it is completely empty. Now, if you own your own house and you really don't care about the ground itself, you don't really have to worry about it, but I put volcano rock or black lava at the bottom of my pits for 2 reasons. Firstly, if I rent my house, I don't want to ruin the ground. I will pretty much scorch the earth just like I was digging a hole and making a real pit fire or a traditional pit fire. I don't want that. This is not my property, I don't want to do that, and I definitely don't want the homeowner coming after me for the deposit later on. Secondly, those black lava rocks seem to keep a lot more heat and make a nice cushion as for if I just left this by itself. My last pit fire was mostly grass, so a lot of the rocks would kind of embed themselves and imprint themselves into the grass or the wet ground. So this is gonna be a tiny bit uneven, just a small tiny bit. The ground is a bit arched here, so it flowers out a little bit for my bricks. So putting this black lava rock is actually really advantageous for me because it's going to fill all the tiny, tiny, tiny little cracks at the bottom of my pit fire kiln, just in case there are any, because the ground is so uneven. Now for the final step, which is just getting my lid that I got from the other pit fire and putting it right on top, and it fits perfectly. You see this? This looks like it took time and effort and planning into your day to build this thing. And it's functional for pottery. And you know what? You don't even have to use it for pottery. If a bunch of friends come over and they want a little pit fire that's safe and contained, here you go. You built this yourself. I prefer this much more over a hole in the ground. It looks much nicer. It's a lot more functional. I can kind of leave this alone as for the fire in my ground for most of the day. Usually with a traditional pit fire, I have to watch it, especially if there's lots of grass around. Well, thank you, Dirty Potters, for joining me today. If you'd like to see any of my actual artwork, I believe I just posted some pit fire pictures up there. The links are always down below for your beautiful potter eyes to see. If you would like to join our Discord or our Facebook fan page community, please go ahead. There's a bunch of other people who are basically into the same stuff I'm into, which is just pottery and art. Also, they might be into dank memes, I don't know. Thank you guys for watching, and I will see you, Dirty Potters, next week. I'm not gonna lie to you. I kind of sort of can't wait to see that guy in the comments below who's like, I actually think a hole in the ground looks a lot better than that.